Assalamu alaikum everyone, and welcome to P2 webinar. Today is day 1st August. I'm your trainer, Hamza Abdullah. I'm an ACCA member, the teaching experience of more than 9 years. I've been teaching since more than 9 years, and I have scored multiple positions in ACCA paper P2 and paper F7. So let's start today's session. What is the agenda of today's session? We are going to have a quick overview of the important areas in paper P2. We are going to understand the approach, how to solve the exam questions. We are going to understand how to plan your answers specifically for section B questions. And we are going to develop some skills to effectively communicate the answer, because it is very important to effectively communicate your answer to the examiner. If you are very good at understanding things, remembering things, but you are very bad at writing things, you won't be able to pass in that case. So what is important is that you should be able to effectively communicate your answer to the examiner. Okay, everyone, I think there was some problem with the mic, and can you people hear me now properly? Yes, Zafar Iqbal is saying yes. Okay, now let's continue. So we were discussing the agenda of today's session. The first point was that we are going to have a quick overview of the important areas in paper P2. We are going to understand the approach on how to solve the exam questions. We are going to understand how to plan your answer specifically for section B questions. And at the end, we are going to develop some skills relevant to effectively communicating your answer to the examiner, because it is very important to write effectively. If you are thinking good, if you are thinking correctly, if you are getting the answer correctly, but you are not able to effectively communicate it to the examiner, in that case, you won't be able to pass. So it is very important to communicate your answer effectively. Now let's have a quick recap of P2 paper pattern. There are two sections, section A and section B. One question in section A and three questions in section B. And out of three questions, you are going to attempt any two of them. So the first question, it has three different parts, part A, part B, and part C. Part A will relate to the consolidation, the preparation of the consolidated financial statements, which will be of 35 marks. So this is a complete calculation-based question of 35 marks. Further, in part B, the theory will be relating to either consolidation or it will be a complete accounting standard. For example, in the previous attempt, the question was related to IFRS 9. Question 1, part B, was relating to IFRS 9. It was a case of factoring. And part C is going to be a question relating to ethics. So part B and part C will make a total of 15 marks. The breakup can be 5 and 10. The breakup can be 7 and 8. The breakup can be 9 and 6. It can be any form of the breakup. So the total marks of question 1 is going to be 50 marks. In section B, first two questions will be relating to accounting standards. Both of them will be of 25 marks each. And the third and the fourth question may relate either to the accounting standard or to any of the current issues area. This is also going to be a question of total 25 marks. So normally people attempt and go for question 2 and question 3 and leave question 4 in the exam. So question number 4 is normally a less attempted question in the exam. So this is a complete overview of the paper pattern. So the areas that we are going to cover in this webinar, in this revision session, is mainly the accounting standards and the area of consolidation. This will be our area of focus, because these marks are mainly the majority of the marks. 50 and 35 makes it 85 marks. So this is going to be the area of our focus. Now let's discuss the overall course plan. There are 6 different days. Day 6 is going to be a mock debrief session, and 5 days we are going to study different accounting standards and consolidation. First 3 days we are going to discuss the accounting standards, and during the next 2 days we will be discussing the consolidation. So 3 days for accounting standards, 2 days for consolidation. In these 3 days we are going to start with IAS 19 today, employee benefits. This is one of the important areas of paper P2 and have been examined in the recent 2 attempts as well. Plus we are going to discuss IFRS 15. It is one of the newly introduced standards. It has been around a year or so, not too much time to be introduced in the exam, so this is also one of the important areas. Day 2 will be IAS 32 and IFRS 9 financial instruments. This is the most difficult area of paper P2. So again, people normally find IFRS 9 a bit difficult. So we are going to discuss this in detail so that the commonly asked areas in the exam can be covered easily. In day 3, we are going to discuss IAS 12 and the new standard of this attempt, that is IFRS 16. So this weighs 3 major standards: IAS 19, financial instruments, IAS 12. 3 of them are the major standards, and remaining 2 are the new standards. IFRS 16 is entirely new in this session, and IFRS 15 has been introduced a year back. So these are the 5 areas that we are going to discuss in this webinar. Some of the people were asking that, why not IFRS 2? Some of the people asked the question on the WhatsApp discussion forum of the webinar. So my answer to that was that IFRS 2 was covered in the previous webinar, which was of June 2017. So IFRS 2 is completely available on the Vimeo channel of ACCA. You can easily go there and review IFRS 2. If there is any question, you can go for them on the WhatsApp webinar group as well. Okay. I will also be going through your questions. So if you have any question, you can post them. And after every few minutes or 10 to 15 minutes, I'm going to see the questions as well, so that I can answer you along. Yes, Ravi and Chandan, we are going to share the webinar link of WhatsApp today, most probably. So you will be able to join over there. So the first 3 days are the days of the accounting standards, and the remaining 2 days is going to relate to the consolidation. We are going to discuss 4 different consolidation areas out of 6. There are total 6 areas: step acquisition, which was being asked in June 2017. Complex groups, which is one of the most expected topics in September 2017, disposal, and the cash flow statements. So these are the 2 areas which are the most important areas. These 2 areas are the most important areas for September 2017 attempt. Plus, the complex groups area cannot be covered without step acquisition, because in case of D-shaped groups, there is a default case of step acquisition as well. So to cover that case, we will also be covering the step acquisition, and we are going to discuss the disposal as well, because sometimes in cash flow questions, the area of disposal is being asked. So cash flow statements may incorporate disposal, and the complex groups may incorporate the step acquisition. Therefore, these are the 4 areas that we are going to discuss, and day 6 is going to be the mock debrief. So this is a quick overview of the entire plan that we are going to cover in this webinar. Now let's start with IES 19 employee benefits, one of the important areas of paper P2. So overview of IES 19, there are total three types of benefits in IES 19, short-term benefit, post-employment benefits, and termination benefits. Short-term benefits is being asked in the past papers only once, and the termination benefit has not yet been asked in the past papers. So normally the question is being asked from the post-employment benefit. Apart from post-employment benefit, there is one more area, other long-term benefits. Other long-term benefits is also a very minor area and is being asked in the past papers only once. So therefore, considering the shortage of time, we are going to focus on the post-employment benefits area in this webinar. So there are two types of post-employment benefits, a defined contribution plan and a defined benefit plan. What's the difference? Now let's have an overview of the post-employment benefits. Let's suppose that there's a company who has made a fund for the benefit of the employees, and the company contributes an annual amount to the fund every year. The company contributes an annual fixed amount to the fund every year. And what does fund do? Fund invests this amount and tries to increase the amount invested by the company until the retirement of the employee. So for example, in year one, the amount paid by the company is being invested by the fund for multiple years. Similarly, year two, a contribution invested by the fund for multiple years. Year three contribution invested by the fund for multiple years. And then when employee retires, that benefit is being paid to the employee. So this is a post-retirement benefit because the benefit to the employee is being paid after the retirement. Therefore, we call it a post-retirement benefit. So this is a complete situation. Now, the question arises that what if there is a loss on the investment? What if the investment was increasing, and then there comes a downfall in the investment and it incurs a loss? So who is going to bear the loss in this case? What is your suggestion? Who is going to bear the loss in this case? Nabil is saying employee. Zafar is saying company, Ansar is saying company, Ravi is saying it can be both, either the employee or the employer. Sultan is saying employee, Aisha employee. Okay, so there are a lot of answers. So some people are saying employee, some people are saying the company, some people are saying the fund, and some people are saying both possible. Okay, so yes, both possibilities exist. The risk may either belong to the company, or the risk may either belong to the employee. So the risk may either belong to both of them. So for example, if the risk belongs to the employee, such case is called a defined contribution plan. If the risk is going to belong to the employee, such case is going to be said to be a defined contribution plan. So in defined contribution plan, after the fixed contribution, once the company has contributed into the fund, company has no further obligation. Once the company has deposited the amount into the fund, if the fund defaults, if there's a loss in the fund, company is not liable for any other amount. The company has already contributed its share of the investment. So company is not liable for any further amount, which also means that the investment risk, the risk of the investment made by the fund, is assumed by the employee or the third party. For example, if there's an insurance, so the risk will not belong to the company, the risk will belong to the insurance company or the employee. So in case of a defined contribution plan, the company, once contributed, has no further obligation, neither legal obligation nor constructive obligation. The company has neither legal obligation nor constructive obligation, which also means that the investment risk is assumed by the employee and the investment risk will not belong to the company. And the benefit will depend on the assets of the fund. The higher the return, the higher the benefit to the employee. The lower the return, the lower the benefit to the employee. So whatever amount is going to be there in the fund is going to be received by the employee. The company cannot benefit from the fund, and the company will not be bearing any loss from the fund. Entire risk and rewards would belong to the employee. This is called a case of a defined contribution plan. But let's suppose if this is not the case and the risk belongs to the company. Let's suppose that the risk belongs to the company. What will happen in this case? In this case, we call it a defined benefit plan, where the company has defined a benefit which the company has promised to the employee. The company is not promising the contribution only in this case. In defined contribution plan, the contribution was the promise of the company. But in case of a defined benefit plan, the contribution is not a promise. The benefit to be provided to the employee is a promise. So in this case, the employer is unable to show that all actuarial risk and investment risk has been transferred to another party. So in this case, the investment risk is going to belong to the company, because in case of any loss, the loss is going to belong to the company. Similarly, in this case, the benefit is normally a predefined formula, because if there is no amount in the fund, the company is going to pay an amount to the employee. What will be that amount? How are we going to calculate that amount? That amount will be a predefined formula that is not solely linked to the amount of the contribution. Like, for example, we may say, employee, that whenever you are going to retire, we are going to give you a pension, which is, let's suppose, 2% of the last salary of the employee. And we are going to pay this amount until when the employee is alive. So this is the benefit that we are going to the employee, for example. So this will become a defined benefit plan, because the benefit is not depending on the assets of the fund and the amount in the fund. Rather, the benefit in this case is a predefined formula. So what is the difference between a defined contribution plan and a defined benefit plan? Is that in defined contribution plan, the investment risk belongs to the employee. And once the company has contributed, the company has no further obligation, neither legal nor constructive. And the third thing is that the benefit to the employee is going to depend on the assets of the fund. The higher the return earned by the fund, the employee is going to receive a higher benefit. The lower the return earned by the fund, the employee is going to receive a lower benefit. But in case of a defined benefit plan, the employee is not going to bear the loss of the loss on the investment by the fund. Rather, the loss will belong to the company, and the amount of benefit received by the employee will be a predefined formula. So if there is any question with this in this regard, you can ask. If there's any question in this regard, you people can ask it. Okay, so I think I'm clear enough. So let's move forward. Now, this is the summary of the post-employment benefits. IS 19 covers two types of post-employment benefits, which we can also say post-employment benefits, which is a defined contribution plan and a defined benefit plan. So in defined contribution plan, the company pays a fixed contribution and has no further legal or constructive obligation. And the actuarial risk and the investment risk of the defined contribution plan are assumed by either the employee or the third party. The company is not going to bear any risk. Now, the plans that are not defined as contribution plans are classed as a defined benefit plan. So we can say there is no specific definition for a defined benefit plan. Rather, all the plans which are not a defined contribution are a defined benefit plans. In this case, the employer will be unable to show that all actuarial risk and investment risk has been transferred, which we have already discussed in the previous slide. So now let's discuss the accounting for a defined contribution plan. In case of a defined contribution plan, the contribution paid by the company is recorded as an expense. The contribution paid by the company is recorded as an expense. So for example, in year one, the company has paid a contribution of 100 million. So the entry that we are going to record is going to be bank credit and expense debit by 100 million. This is the amount that has been contributed by the company. Any unpaid amount is treated as a liability. So for example, the amount to be paid was 110, but the company has only paid 100. So in this case, we are going to increase the expense by 10 million. And as the amount is unpaid, we are going to record this as a liability. So any unpaid amount is treated as a liability, and any overpaid amount is treated as an asset. So for example, the amount to be paid was 90 million, but the company has paid 100 million. So what is going to happen is that we are going to record the expense of 90 instead and not 100. The remaining 10 million is going to be treated as an asset because this amount is a type of a receivable. The amount is assumed to be recoverable. So any overpaid amount is treated as an asset only if it is expected to be recovered. But if the amount is not expected to be recovered, what will happen in that case is that we are going to treat that amount as an expense. So for example, if the amount is not recoverable, we are going to treat this as an expense as well. So there are only three points that you have to remember. The contribution paid by the company is recorded as an expense. Any unpaid amount is a liability. Any overpaid amount is an asset if it can be recovered. Otherwise, it is also an expense. So these are the three minor points that you have to remember for defined contribution plan. So let's have an example. Example, ABC Limited has a payroll cost of $5 million for the year ended 31st December 2015. The company has a defined contribution scheme or a defined contribution plan and pays pension contribution of 5% of the salary cost each year. So the company has to pay $5 million into 5%, which is going to give us a value of $0.25 million. Now the question says that during the year, ABC Limited paid 0.2 million and will pay over the balance in January 2016. So what entry are we going to record is that we will be recording the expense at 0.25 million and the amount paid is only 0.2 million and the remaining 0.05 million is going to be treated as a liability. So this is the entry that we are going to record in case of a defined contribution plan. Okay. So there are a few questions. Let's have them quickly. Mohammed Bilal, your question relates to a defined benefit plan. We are going to discuss this in the later slides. So it will be covered. There's a question, what is the second difference? I have discussed total three differences. The first is that the company's liability. If the company has contributed in the fund and the company is no more liable, it is a defined contribution plan. Further, in this case, the investment risk will belong to the employee because the company has no liability. So if there is any loss, it will belong to the employee. And if there is a higher gain, it will belong to the employee as well. And the third difference was that the benefit. In case of a contribution plan, the benefit will depend on the assets of the fund. In case of a defined benefit plan, the benefit will be a predefined formula. So these were the differences which we have discussed. Asad, you can post your question over here where you have written that where can I post the questions to the tutor. I will be able to view the questions over here. There's another question. What are their accounting treatment and cash flows? We will be discussing the cash flow statement in day five. So we will be covering this question over there. Ravi is asking, where will the plan as for the liability go in a cash flow? Again, Ravi, the cash flow area will be discussed in day five. So right now we are focusing on IAS 19 as a standalone topic. In the later slides, we will be embedding IAS 19 into consolidation, into income statement, into disposal, into cash flow statements. So your question relates to that area mainly. Intizar Hussain is asking, any overpaid amount can also reduce the contribution for the next year? Yes, Intizar. When we say that the amount is recoverable, it can be recoverable in terms of cash. It can be recoverable in terms of reduction in the next contribution. It can be recoverable at the time when the employee is leaving. If the amount is recoverable in any form, it is an asset. Muhammad Hassan is asking, is non-recoverable overpayment adjusted in next year's liability? No, Muhammad Hassan, the non-recoverable amount means that it cannot be adjusted anywhere. So that will be an expense entirely. There's another question. Can you please repeat the difference in benefits? Okay, let me go back. To this slide. I'm repeating the difference in the benefit. Like for example, in a defined contribution plan, after the contribution, the company is not liable. Which means that whatever amount is in the fund belongs to the employee. Higher value, higher benefit to the employee. Lower value in the fund, lower benefit to the employee. So in case of contribution plan, the benefit depends on the assets in the fund. Higher assets, higher benefit. Lower assets, lower benefit. But in case of a defined benefit plan, as the benefit is a formula, so the employee is going to receive that amount irrespective of whether the fund has that amount or not. So for example, in case of a defined benefit plan, if the company has to pay 100 million and the fund has 150 million, so the employee will receive only 100, not 150. Remaining 50 will belong to the company. But in case of a contribution plan, the entire 150 million will belong to the employee. So this is the difference of the benefit. Your question relates to the admin. They will be answering you to your question. Asad Mannan is asking, is the fund a separate company or is it the employer? Asad, the fund can be a separate company. It is normally a separate company, in fact, but in some cases the plan may be unfunded, where the company is not preparing a fund and the company is storing the amount with its own self. Okay, so there's a question. So if company always contribute more, it can decrease or increase its gain and losses. Yes, your question is right, but in case of a defined benefit plan only. Ansar is asking, for a defined contribution plan, if the fund goes into liquidation, does the employee has a minimum claim? Ansar, in case of a defined contribution plan, the employee has simply a receivable and the fund has simply a payable. So if the fund goes into liquidation, the amount that the fund has will be paid to the employee and the remaining will be a loss to the employee. Arsham is asking that what if the company experiences a loss in defined benefit plan, that what will the company do? Okay, there are certain questions that we are going to discuss in the later slides as well. So I think that once we move on, the areas will be more specifically clear. So I'm taking the last question of Intizar Hussain. Can company use the excess amount for business operations after the benefit has been paid? Intizar, this depends on the rules of the fund. In normal circumstances, assuming that there is no restriction by the fund, yes, the company can use the remaining balance in case of a defined benefit plan, but not in case of a contribution plan. So now let's move further. Now we are moving towards the accounting for defined benefit plan. Now we are discussing the accounting for a defined benefit plan. Now let's suppose that this is the employment term of the employee. For example, the company has a rule that if the employee works for 20 years in the company, then the company can, then the employee can take the retirement and the benefit will be paid to the employee after the employee's retirement. So this is the date of retirement. This is the term of employment and this is the life that the employee is living after the retirement. So now in case of a defined benefit plan, the benefit paid to the employee will be after the retirement. This is the term where we are going to pay the benefit to the employee. But the payment At what point of time do you think that this payment should be recorded as an expense? During the employment term or when the amount is paid? At what time, I'm repeating my question, at what time do you think that the amount should be expensed out? During the employment of 20 years or after the retirement when the employees when the amount is paid to the employee? What is your suggestion? Dinesh is saying employment. Mohammed Muzammil is saying during the employment, over the period of time, when the service is received, during the employment. Yes, exactly. The expense will be recorded during the term of the employment because, according to the matching concept, the company is receiving the benefit from the employee during his employment term. So the expense should also be recorded during the employment term. So this is the time when the expense of benefits paid should be recorded over the employment period. So any expected amount that we are going to pay after retirement should be distributed over 20 years. So we can say that the expense allocated to each year is called a current service cost. So for example, if we are paying an amount of $20 million in total after retirement in present value terms, so this amount is going to be recorded over 20 years and the expense for each year is going to be 1 million. So this 1 million is basically the current service cost. This is called the current service cost. The amount paid to the employee after retirement being allocated or spread over the employment term is called a current service cost. So this is only an estimated cost. So this is only an estimated cost. Secondly, all values will be recorded in present value terms as the payment is being made after 20 years, and maybe the employee is going to live further 10 to 20 years after the retirement. So the cash being paid is over a 40-year period. So obviously, the present value will be required because the time value of money today and after 20 to 40 years will be different. So all values will be recorded in present value terms, and whenever we record a liability in terms of present value, the liability increases every year. When we record the liability at a present value, the liability increases every year, which we call unwinding, or we may also say compounding. So all values are going to be recorded in present value terms, and will be and we will be unwinding them at each year. Further, at the end of each year, the estimated payment, which we have already discussed in the first bullet as well, the estimated cost may change over this 20-year period. So what we do is that at the end of each year, the estimate will be reassessed. We reassess our estimate at each year end, and the liability will be recorded at the new estimate. So for example, initially we thought that we are going to pay 20 million, which will be recorded over 20 years, resulting in an expense of 1 million. And later on, we think that the amount to be paid will be, let's say, 30 million. So spreading it over 20 years will make now the expense at being 1.5 million. So as the estimates are going to change over the 20-year period, the liability will also be changed, and the current service cost will also be changed for every year. In year one, the current service cost will be different. In year two, the current service cost will be different. In year three, the current service cost will be different. And the difference in the estimates will create a gain or a loss. Like in this case, the estimates have changed in such a manner that it will result in a loss to the company. So we call this loss a remeasurement loss. And if it's a gain, we call it a remeasurement gain. So any change in the estimates will result in a remeasurement gain or a remeasurement loss to the company. Further, the company will also be recording a fund and maintaining a fund and contributing an amount every year to the fund. So how we are going to create that how we are going to treat that fund in the financial statements is that the fund will be treated as an asset. This time the fund is an asset for the company because the risk and rewards of the fund belongs to the company. And If you remember the definition of an asset, we call that asset is a resource controlled by the company. So in this case, the fund will be controlled by the company, and the risk and rewards will also belong to the company. So the fund will be treated as an asset. But in case of a defined contribution plan, the fund is not an asset because the company does not have the risk and rewards of the fund. Now, secondly, the interest earned by the fund. The fund is obviously investing the amount and gaining return. The interest earned by the fund will be the income for the company. Any amount earned by the fund is the income of the company because that amount belongs to the company. The risk and reward belongs to the company. So any loss relates to company, any gain to the fund relates to the company. The employee does not have the risk and rewards of the fund in this case. And the last, that contribution into the fund will increase the fund. So any amount contributed by the company each year will increase the amount of the fund. So let's suppose I say that this is a fund. Let's assume this to be a fund, and I'm contributing 10 million in the first year. So this is my asset. This will help me in paying my liability to the employee. This will help me in satisfying the promise that I've made to the employee. So this is an asset for me. I've put in $10 million in year one. So this asset is of 10 million. In year two, I again put $10 million further. So now the fund is of $20 million. And this is going to help me paying my liability. So this is an asset for me. Plus the asset, the fund, is not just keeping the amount that I have put in. It is investing that 10, 20 million and gaining some extra return. So maybe possible that I have invested 20, but the fund has 30. The additional 10 million is the interest earned by the fund. So there will be two types of amounts received by the fund, the contribution and the interest. Plus, whenever the employee will retire and we will fulfill our promise of paying the benefit, from where are we going to pay the benefit? We will be paying from the fund. So the fund is going to pay the benefit to the employees. So total, we can say that there are three roles of the fund. We are contributing into the fund, the fund is investing and gaining some return, and the fund is paying the amount to the employee. So these are the three activities of the fund. And for the liability, for the promise that I've made to the employee, we are going to record the current service cost at present value. We are going to unwind it at each year end, and we are going to revise the liability at each year end, which will result in a remeasurement gain or a remeasurement loss. So this is a quick overview of the defined benefit plan. I'm looking at your questions, few of your questions. Okay. Irfan is unable to hear my voice. Irfan, are you facing the problem still? You are facing the problem? Mohammad Hassan is saying that estimate will be changed in estimate as per IS8. Yes, Mohammad Hassan, the accounting treatment is the same as per IS8. There is no difference in the accounting treatment. Munib Hassan is asking, explain the previous point of the remeasurement cost. Munib, we are going to discuss the remeasurement cost again in the next slide. So that will be covered over there. Okay, Irfan, it's good that you can hear now. Intizar Hussain is asking, sir, what is the past service cost? Intizar, we are going to discuss this in the future slides as well. So don't worry. Okay, Iman is also asking to discuss the remeasurement gain or loss. Okay, let me discuss it again. I'm removing the few points from over here so that I can get some space to write. Okay, I'm discussing the remeasurement gain or loss again. So the values that I'm going to take will be only an estimate for the purpose of understanding that this is not going to be the exact calculation in the real life. So for example, this is a 20-year period where the employee has to work before retirement. And we are estimating that the employee will live 10 years further after the retirement. And we calculate the amount at the end of year one. We are at year one, estimating the amount that we have to pay. And we calculate that this estimated amount to be paid is 20 million. which shall be recorded over 20 years, resulting in an expense of 1 million for each year. So let's assume that in year 1 we have recorded 1 million. And when we are at the end of year 2, our estimate changes, and our new estimate is that we may be paying $30 million to this employee. And spreading it over 20 years will result in an annual cost of $1.5 million. So the current service cost has increased, and similarly, the liability at year 2 will also increase from 2 million, 1 million for each year, to 3 million, 1.5 million for each year. So this 1 million can be said to be a remeasurement loss. This loss relates basically to the change in the estimate, to the remeasurement of the estimates. So this amount is called a remeasurement loss. Similarly, this may be a gain if the current service cost decreases in the later years. So I hope I am clear. Taha is asking, can it be 25 marks question? Yes, Taha, it can be a 25 marks question, but the chances are low. Din is asking that in the defined benefit plan, does the employee already know which amount they will receive at the retirement? The employees do not know the exact amount. Rather, they know a formula according to which the amount will be paid. In some cases, the amount can also be defined, but not in all cases. Ansar is asking, do we actually have to estimate employee life after retirement to do the estimate calculation? If yes, does ACCA have guidelines for it? Ansar, basically, the calculation of the current service cost and the liability and the estimate of the life of the employee and the estimate of the last salary of the employee, all these areas are based on some estimates. And IAS 19 recommends that you do not do this on your own as an accountant. Rather, IAS 19 recommends to use the services of an actuary. But all these areas are not examinable. These are some general basic points for the understanding purposes only. So you will not be calculating these amounts in the real life or in the exam. You will be given the current service cost. You will be given the amount of the liability, and your motive will be to do the accounting on those values rather than calculating those values. Ali Minas is saying, sir, how can we account for the gain on curtailment? Ali Minas, we are going to discuss the curtailment as well. So now let's move further. So there's another point, fourth point, which is that the benefit will be paid from the fund, which will decrease the fund. And we have already discussed this, that what is fund going to do is that the amount that we are investing in it, the contribution, it will be recording that, it will be paying the benefit to the employee, and it will be investing the amount to gain some return. So now this is the accounting table that we are going to use in our examples and the exam as well. And a similar table is being used in the practical life as well. So now in the first column, we are going to account for the liability. We are going to record the movement of the liability. What does DBO stand for? DBO is the defined benefit obligation. This is the liability. This is the promise that we have done to the employee. And what is a plan asset? Plan asset is the fund. The fund where we are contributing the amount, the fund which is investing and gaining some return, the fund which is paying the benefit. It is also called a plan asset. Or we can also say a plan, only a plan. So it can be a plan. We can call it a plan asset. We can call it a fund. There are three different names to be used. And the difference between the liability and the asset is the net liability. So for example, if I have to pay the employees 10 million and I have 6 million, I have to pay 10 million and I have 6 million. So remaining 4 million is the liability that is on the company. So we call this a net liability. The liability ultimately that will fall onto the company after paying from the fund. So now every year there will be a brought down balance of the liability and the plan asset. Every year there will be a brought down of the liability and the plan asset. And when we are going to unwind the liability, when we are going to unwind the liability, it will increase the liability, and we call this expense an interest expense. So for example, if the brought down was 100 million and the interest rate is 10%, so the interest expense is going to be 10. So the liability will increase by 10. Similarly, in every year, we are going to record the current service cost. So let's suppose that the current service cost for year 2 is 30 million. So the 100 was the brought down liability, the 10 was the unwinding, and the 30 is the further expense in the liability for the current year. Similarly, the contribution paid, whenever we are contributing the amount into the fund, what will this contribution have an impact on the liability? What do you say? What will the amount of contribution into the fund will have an impact on the liability? Increase liability. Asad is saying no impact. Hassan is saying no impact. Neelam is saying increase in asset. Intizar is saying contribution paid will decrease liability. No impact, no impact. Reduction in... Okay, yes. The contribution into the fund will have no impact on the liability. The contribution into the fund will have no impact on the liability because when I contribute into the fund, has this contribution fulfilled my promise to the employee? No. Because what was my promise? That I am going to give you the benefit. I haven't given the benefit yet. I have only contributed in the fund. The benefit is not provided to the employee yet. Therefore, this will have no impact on the liability. Rather, this will increase the assets in the fund. This will increase the value of the fund. This will increase the amount that the fund have to pay the liability. But the liability has not yet been paid. You can understand in this in such a manner that, for example, your exam fees is a liability on you. Your annual subscription is a liability on you. You have to pay that every year. So for example, you know that you have to pay the annual subscription for 2018. So what you do is that you take out the pounds that you have to pay and you keep them in a box, safe and secure. This is your fund. You have taken out the annual subscription from your bank and you are putting it in a box, a fund. So have you paid the liability? Have you paid the annual subscription? No, the liability has not yet been paid. Rather, a separate asset is being developed to pay the liability. So in this case, this will not impact the liability, rather will increase the plan asset, will increase the fund. Plus, whenever the benefits will be paid to the employee, whenever the fund is going to pay an amount to the employee, in that case, my liability will reduce because I have fulfilled my promise. So that will decrease my liability, plus it will also decrease the amount in the fund. So if I had contributed 10 and the fund has paid 2, so the fund will have 8. So the amount of benefits paid will reduce the asset as well as the liability. And at the year end, we are going to reassess the liability again as per the new estimates. So for example, the benefits paid were $2 million. So the liability that this would make will be 138. The sum of all these is going to be 138. But let's suppose when we reassess the liability at the year end, we get a liability of 150, which means that we have to increase the liability by 12 million and we are going to call this a remeasurement loss of $12 million. So every year we are going to reassess the liability with the loss and the gain called as the remeasurement gain or loss. Plus, if you look at the plan asset, the brought down balance was the amount that the plan had at the start of the year. The contribution is the amount that we have paid further. The benefits paid is the amount that the fund has paid to the employee. Now, obviously the fund is not keeping the amount with itself. Rather, the fund is investing the amount and gaining a return. So that is going to be the interest income. But let's suppose that the fund had 80 million at the start of the year. The fund had a balance of 80 million at the start of the year. And as a person, as a company, I would want the fund to earn at least a return of 10%. I would want the fund to earn a return of at least 10%, because my liability is increasing by 10%. So at a minimum, my assets should also increase by 10%. So the interest income that we are going to record is 8. This is not the actual return earned by the fund. This is the expected return earned by the fund that we want fund to earn at the lower side. But let's suppose the fund earns an amount of $15 million. We were expecting 8, but the fund has earned $15 million. How much above my expectation? 7 million above my expectation. This 7 million is going to become the remeasurement gain of financial asset. So the amount earned above my expectation by the fund is the remeasurement gain. And if the fund had earned an amount lower than my expectation, it would have become a remeasurement loss. So in case of fund, in case of plan asset, amount above my expectation, gain; amount below my expectation, loss. So I had 80 million. I wanted the fund to earn 8 million. I have, let's suppose, contributed an amount of 20 million further, and the benefits paid were of 2 million, and the remeasurement gain is of 7 million. Now at the year end, the fund will be having a balance of 88, 95, 105, and minus 2 is going to be 103. So this is the balance that the fund is going to have at the year end. Now, looking at these two columns, we are going to prepare a column for the net liability. The liability was 100, the fund was 80, which means that the company was liable for 20 million. The interest expense was 10, the interest income was 8, which means that the net interest to the company is 2. The current service cost was 30, which had no impact on the asset, so the liability has increased by 30. Similarly, the contribution paid will increase the plan asset and will reduce the liability. So I can say that net liability is simply DBO minus plan asset. Net liability is simply DBO minus plan asset. Whatever value is going to be, value is going to result from DBO minus plan asset will go in the net liability. And in case of benefits paid, the amount will be zero, because DBO is also negative 2 and plan asset also is negative 2. So there is no difference between both of them. So the impact of the benefits paid on the net liability is going to be zero. And in case of remeasurement, 12 minus 7 is going to give us a loss of 5. 12 was the remeasurement loss, 7 was the remeasurement gain. So a net remeasurement loss of 5 million, and the carried down liability is going to be 47 million, which is 150 minus 103. So this is how we prepare a movement of the liability, of the plan asset, and of the net liability. Now let's look at a few of your questions. Aisha Mushtaq is asking that, sir, remeasurement gain loss arise when we apply asset ceiling limit. Aisha, remeasurement gain your loss does not apply because of the asset ceiling. The gain or loss, in fact, the loss on asset ceiling is something different, and we are going to discuss that later on. Rohit is asking that, is this the actuarial gain or loss reassessed one? Yes, Rohit, we can also say this an actuarial gain or loss. So both the terms remeasurement gain or loss or actuarial gain or loss can be used interchangeably. Varda Hussain is saying that the total is 113, not 103. Okay, Varda, let me recalculate. 108, 115. Yeah, this is 113. So the net liability is going to be 37. Thank you for correcting. Okay, so I'm going to look at some further questions. Akib Yusuf is saying that we cannot see the very right side of the screen where the net liability column exists. Okay, Yusuf, Akib, don't worry. We are going to solve the question, and I will make sure that I do not write on the rightmost side of the screen. Please do remind me if I forget. Muhammad Mustafa is saying that why is there an interest expense on liability and what does it mean? Mustafa, we had discussed it previously that the liability is being recorded at the present value. The liability is being recorded at the present value. And whichever amount is recorded at the present value, we unwind that amount at each year end. So this interest is basically the unwinding expense of the present value. Irfan is saying it's 113. Yes, Irfan, I've corrected it. Varda is saying net liability is not 30, 47, it's 37. Okay. Okay, so now the questions are done. Let's move forward. Now there's another small point that you have to remember. We may not be having too much time to go into too much detail of this, but we will be covering this up to the extent of the exam only. So in case of any unpaid contribution, if there is any amount which is not being paid by the company at the year end. So let's say the company had to pay 10 million as a contribution into the fund, but the company has paid only 8 million. So 2 million is going to be the unpaid contribution because this amount is not yet being paid. So how we are going to treat this? In case of any unpaid contribution, it shall be deducted from the contribution paid. So in this case, the contribution paid will not be 10, rather we will be deducting 2, and the amount to be used in the plan asset is going to be 8. Obviously, this is just an example, so we will be solving this in a complete question as well. So any unpaid contribution is deducted from the contribution paid, plus it is also deducted from the carried forward amount of the plan asset. So for example, if the plan asset value was given to you by the question, which was 113, you will be deducting 2 from it and you will be using the carried down of 111, because the carried down given by the question would include the unpaid contribution as well. So we are going to remove the unpaid contribution from two areas, from the amount of contribution paid and from the carried down of the plan asset. Okay, now let's discuss the past service cost. What is a past service cost? Let's suppose that we had promised the employees that we are going to pay them a pension of 2% of their last salary. We are going to pay a pension of 2% of the last salary of the employees. But later we decide to change the promise and we change the promise that now we are going to pay the employees 4% of their last salary as the pension. So this is a change in the pension entitlement, a change in the promise that we have done to the employee. So what will this change have an impact on our liability is that when we have increased the promise, the pension liability would also increase. And if we have decreased the promise, the pension liability will also decrease. So the change in the pension liability, the change in the pension liability due to the change in the promise, due to the change in the pension entitlement is called the past service cost. So let's suppose the liability according to the previous promise was $10 million. The liability according to the new promise is, let's suppose, $20 million. So this increase in liability is due to the new, to the change in the promise. So we will be saying that this amount is the past service cost. So the past service cost is the change in the liability due to the change in the pension entitlement. Past service cost may be either positive or negative. What is a positive past service cost? Where pension entitlements have been increased. And when we have reduced the pension entitlement, we will call it a negative past service cost. So the past service cost may be a positive past service cost or maybe a negative past service cost, depending whether we have increased or whether we have reduced the promise or the pension entitlement. So there's one more point that you have to remember in this case is that all past service costs. Now, what do we have to do with this past service cost? Is that we will say all past service costs, which means both positive and negative, will be recorded in P&L immediately. So all past service cost will be recorded in P&L immediately, whether it is positive or it is negative. Now let's discuss the curtailment and settlement. What is curtailment? When we substantially reduce the number of employees in the pension entitlement, in the pension plan, it is called curtailment. When we substantially decrease the number of employees in the pension plan, it is called curtailment. If the reduction is not substantial, if the reduction of employees is not substantial, we call it a past service cost. We treat it as a past service cost. But if the reduction is a substantial reduction, we call it a curtailment. Now the curtailment may either be with settlement or maybe without settlement. So if the curtailment is without settlement, which means that we have reduced the number of employees from the plan and we haven't paid any further amount to them. We have reduced the number of employees, but we haven't paid any further amount to them. In this case, the liability is going to be DBO debit, liability debit, and gain on curtailment credit. So the reduction in liability is simply a gain for the company. But if we are paying an amount to the employee as well, it may either be overpaid or be underpaid. So if we are paying an extra amount to the employee, that will become a loss on settlement. Let's say that the liability was of 100 and we have paid an amount of 110. So we have paid an excess of 10. So 10 million is the loss on settlement. But let's say that the liability was 100, but we have only paid 80. So we have underpaid by the amount of 20 million. So any overpaid, underpaid is treated as a gain or loss. If we are paying more, loss, we are paying less, gain. And we call this gain on settlement. So this is the simple accounting of curtailment and settlement. Asad is saying that past service costs are positive or negative from the point of view of employee. Yes, Asad, yes. If we are increasing the benefit, so that will be a positive past service cost, decreasing will be negative. Intizar Hussain is saying, does past service cost increases unwinding? Intizar, this may increase the unwinding if the past service cost at the start of the year. But if we are changing the plan at the end of the year, that won't affect the unwinding. Varda Hussain is asking that when we are going to take the namaz break. Whether we are going to take the namaz break, in around 7 minutes, 7 to 8 minutes. So now let's move further. Now this is the table again of the post-employment benefit, but this time I have added the past service cost and the curtailment settlement. Brought forward is the same that we have discussed earlier. Interest is the same, current service cost is the same, contribution the same, benefits paid the same, remeasurement the same, carried forward the same. Only two areas have been added in this table now. The past service cost. Past service cost is going to increase the liability and will have no impact on the fund. Because if I am increasing my promise to the employee, what impact will this have on the fund? No impact. I have increased my promise, I have increased my liability, but it will have no impact on the fund. And in case of curtailment settlement, the amount of curtailment means the reduction in the liability. The amount of curtailment means the amount by which the liability has been reduced. And The amount of settlement means that the amount we have paid from the fund. So settlement will be reduced from the fund and curtailment will be reduced from the liability DBO. So this is how we are going to incorporate these into the table. Akib is asking, once examiner asked why past service cost is classified in P&L and why not in OCI. Akib, this is pretty simple, that because past service cost is basically a type of a current service cost. If I have promised the employee a pension of 2%, so the current service cost is 2%. But when I change my plan and I say 4% benefit will be given, so the current service cost has increased for the past years as well, where I was recording 2%. So the past service cost is actually adjusting the current service cost in the previous years. And because the current service cost is being recorded in P&L, the past service cost is also recorded in P&L. Why not OCI? Because in OCI, remeasurement gains and losses are taken. And remeasurement gains and losses are the change in the estimates. This is not a change in the estimate. This is a change that I've done willingly. This is not a change in estimate. Estimate means that a change that does not depend on my will. But past service cost, I will change if I want to change. So that's why it is recorded in P&L and not OCI. Din is asking, what do you mean without settlement? Din, without settlement means that we have reduced the employees and we have not paid any amount to them. We have cancelled our promise. We have cancelled our promise and we are not paying any additional amount. Thai is asking, okay, that what is the substantial amount of employees? There is no definition of substantial number of employees, but the substantial employees will depend according to the company. So for example, if there is a company of 5 employees, so we will say, okay, even one employee is substantial. One employee may be substantial. But if a company is having an employees of 5,000 employees, in that case, the substantial number will be different. So this is something subjective and depending on the company's size of the company. Taha is again asking, at what time IFRS will be started? Taha cannot comment about the time, but we are planning to start IFRS 5 latest by 8:15 p.m. in Pakistan time. Uzair is asking, we add past service cost in DBO even if it is positive. Yes, Uzair, we add if it is positive, and if it is negative, we will reduce that, because negative past service cost will reduce the liability. On question, it will be given either settlement or curtailment. Yes, it will be given the question whether it is curtailment only or whether it is a curtailment with settlement. Hussain Abbas is asking, impact on interest if the contribution paid during the year, that is after 6 months. Hassan, we are going to discuss this also. Okay, now let's continue with the slides. We are also short of time. Now we are discussing example one, defined benefit plan. This is a question where the present value opening was 210, present value closing is 378, fair value of plan asset opening is 168, fair value of plan asset closing is 294, current service cost 63, past service cost at 1st January 2013. This date is very important while we will be calculating the interest. So past service cost is 21, total contribution is 105, and unpaid is 42, which means that paid contribution is going to be 105 minus 42, which will give us an answer of 63. And benefits paid again at the start of the year was 20, curtailment was 5, settlement was 6. This means that there is a loss on curtailment on settlement of 1 million. Curtailment is of 5, settlement is of 6. So there is a loss of 1 million and the discount rate is 10%. So now let's quickly solve this question and then we will be taking a namaz break of 10 minutes and then we will come back and continue. Yes, Taha, we will be solving multiple past papers questions, which have if you already have the presentations, you will be having the questions as well. Okay, now starting from brought forward, Liability brought forward is 210 and asset brought forward is 168. So we will be writing 210 and 168. Interest we are going to calculate at the end, because we have to be very specific in calculating the interest with respect to the cash flows or the values which are at the start of the year. So current service cost, let's see the current service cost and the past service cost. If I move back, the current service cost was 63 and the past service cost was 21. So both of them will be written in the liability section and these will not have an impact on the plan asset. Now the next area is curtailment and settlement. Moving back again, curtailment was 5 and settlement was 6. So 5 negative in DBO and 6 negative in plan asset. And now the amount of contribution paid, this was 105 minus 42. Plus, we are also going to reduce this 42 from the carried down of the plan asset as well. So this will give us a total of 63 and the contribution will increase the asset and not will have no impact on the liability. Now the benefits paid are of 20. So we are going to reduce 20 from the plan asset and the liability. So this will have no impact on the net liability. Now the carried down values are 378 and 294. So this will be 378 and 294 minus 42, which will give us a total of 252. So these are now the carried down values that have been given in the question. Now before calculating the remeasurement gain or loss, we are going to calculate the interest first. While calculating the interest, what do we have to do is that we have to identify the values that are given at the start of the year. So there are total two values, the past service cost and the benefits paid. So what we are going to do is that we are going to write the brought down of liability of 210 and the brought down of the plan asset of 168. So this is at the start of the year and this is at the start of the year. So the amount of past service cost was 21. So we are going to add 21 in this. So 210 plus 21. I'm writing it at the bottom. 210 plus 21. And the benefits paid were also at the start of the year. So we are also going to reduce 20. So this will give us a total of 211. So 211 is the value at the start of the year. We are going to unwind 211, not 210. The values at the start are going to be adjusted first and then we are going to calculate the unwinding, which is of 10%. The 10% rate was given in the question. If the question gives you two different rates, an opening rate and a closing rate, so in that case, you will be using the opening rate, not the closing one. So 10% will give us an interest expense of 21.1. And for the plan asset, it will be 168. The past service cost will not impact the plan asset, but the benefits paid will do. So we are going to reduce 20 from 168. That will give us a total of 148. And 10% of 148 will be 14.8. So this will give us a total of 14.8 and this one was 21.1. So these two values relates to the interest and now we can calculate the balancing figures. I'm going to use a calculator. So this will be 210 plus 21.1 plus 63 plus 21 minus 5 minus 20. This is 290.1 and if I deduct from 378, this means that it will be 87.9 positive. Positive 87.9 means that this is a remeasurement loss. Similarly, for plan asset, it will be 168 plus 14.8 minus 6 plus 63 and minus 20, which is 219.8 minus 252 will give us a total of 32.2. So 32.2 positive in the asset will be called a remeasurement gain. Increase in asset is a gain and increase in liability is a loss. So now 210 minus 168, this is 42. 21.1 minus 14.8 is going to be 6.3. This was 14.8. This was 21.1. I don't know why the values are being rubbed it by themselves. Let me close the slideshow and rerun it. Now let's try again. Selecting a pen. 21.1, 14.8. This was 6.3. And 210 plus 21.1 plus 63 plus 21 minus 5 minus 20 minus 378 was 87.9. Okay, so 210 minus 168 is 42. 21.1 minus 14.8 is 6.3. This will be 63. This will be 21. And now minus 5 minus minus 6 is going to be minus 5 plus 6, which will give us an answer of positive 1. So in case of curtailment settlement, the positive 1 will be calculated as I've done on the top. So contribution will be negative 63 and benefits paid 0. 87.9 minus 6.3 is going to give us a total of 81.6, and 378 minus 252 will be 126. So this is how we are going to prepare the movement in the plan asset and the liability. Now quickly going through your question, and then we'll be taking the namaz break. Muhammad Hassan is asking that loss on curtailment will be recorded in P&L. Yes, Muhammad Hassan, loss on settlement, curtailment, everything in P&L. Din is asking why deducted 42 from the carried forward for the plan asset. Din, the fair value of the plan asset would include the unpaid contribution as well as a type of a receivable. So we are going to eliminate that. Hassan is asking, can you please explain again how you reach 21? Hassan, 21 was given in the question, the past service cost of 21. So I've used this amount in the calculation of the interest. Muhammad Hassan is saying, please repeat 14.8 and 21.1. Okay. I'm repeating it. Starting with 21.1, the brought down of the liability was 210. And these are the two values that were at the start of the year, 21 and 20. 21 is positive and 20 is negative. So I will adjust these two values from the brought down first, which will give us a total of 211. And we are going to record 10% of 211, which will give us a total of 21.1. So this is how we have calculated 21.1. And for 14.8, we use the brought down of 168 of the plan asset, and then we reduce the benefits paid of 20. So this was 148, and 10% of 148 was 14.8. So this is how we have reached to 14.8 and to 21.1. Now Rohit is asking that why benefits paid is adjusted from the opening balance for interest calculation purpose, as it might have been paid during the current year. Rohit, the question had mentioned that the benefits were paid at the start of the year. So because they are being paid on the 1st January 2013, which was the first day of the year, that's why we have reduced it from the brought down to calculate the interest. Further, Rohit is asking again, if discounted and expected return on plan asset are given, which one should be picked? Rohit, the expected return on plan asset was something which was used in the past. After the last change of IAS 19 in 2011, the concept of expected return has been removed. So you are going to use the discount rate for both the liability and the plan asset. So there is no more concept of expected return. Now, PS is asking that can we see the interest expense in DBO? PS, this was the interest expense of DBO, how we have calculated this. Mohammed Hassan is saying remeasurement gain or loss on asset is not 6.3 but 32.2. Okay, let me check again. 168 plus 14.8 minus 6 plus 63 minus 20 minus 252. Okay. It is 32.2. So this will be 87.9 minus 32.2 being 55.7. Let me recheck also. 42 plus 6.3 plus 63 plus 21 plus 1 minus 63 plus 55.7 is 126. Okay. Now I have recalculated the amounts. Din is also asking the same. Imran is asking, please repeat curtailment. Is it different from settlement? Imran, curtailment is the decrease in the liability and settlement is the amount that we have paid against it. So if I had promised an employee that I will give him benefit at the end and I have cancelled my promise, so the cancellation will reduce my liability, that is called curtailment. And the amount that I have paid to the employee in return is called the settlement. Batul is asking, is remeasurement for plan asset correct? Batul, I've already corrected it. Thank you for correcting me. And Guang is asking that why discounted using opening rate instead of closing rate? Guang, basically the interest rates, for example, this is the entire year. The opening rate was 10%. The closing rate is 12%. So the rates are being used after they are announced rather than before they are announced. So the rate announced at the end of the year should be used for the future payments, not for the time that was during the year. So we will be using 10% for the entire calculation, and when the liability carried down will be calculated, that would use 12%. So the difference between 10 and 12 will go into the remeasurement gain or loss. So for the purpose of accounting throughout the year, we will be using 10%. And the liability carried down will be using 12%. The difference will go into the remeasurement gain or loss. Okay, now let's have a short break, namaz break for 10 minutes, and then we are going to come back and continue from over here. So right now it's 7:30 with me. We will be resuming at 7:40 p.m. in Pakistan time. Okay, everyone, welcome back. And before the break, we were solving the example number one. So let's move on. We had calculated the movement of defined benefit obligation, the liability, the plan asset, and the net liability. Now which values should be taken further to P&L, and which value should be taken to OCI, and which value should be taken to the balance sheet? Let's see that the interest expense, the current service cost, the past service cost, and the curtailment and settlement, these are the values which would be taken to P&L as an expense. And further, the remeasurement gain or loss should be taken to OCI. And the final value which should be taken to the balance sheet as a non-current liability is going to be 126. So these are the three values which will be taken to the income statement and the balance sheet. And if we are making a double entry, in that case, we will be using 63 million as well. This is the amount which has been deducted from the bank. And we will also be using the opening liability, which was 42. So for example, if I move on to the next slide and I write down these values over here, the interest cost was 6.3. Current service cost was 63, this is 6.3, 63, 21, and 1. So the total of all these is going to be 84, 85, and 91.3. The total expense in P&L is going to be 91.3. The value in OCI is going to be the remeasurement gain or loss, which is 55.7. This is a loss. And the value to be taken in the balance sheet is going to be 126, being the net liability carried down. And if we record a double entry over here, so we will debit the P&L by 91.3. We will be debiting OCI by 55.7. We will be crediting the bank by the amount of contribution paid, which was 63 in this question. So bank credit by 63. And last, the non-current liability being credited. The opening liability was 42 and the closing liability is 126. So from 42 to 126, the liability is to be increased by 84 million. So we are going to credit the liability by 84. Just to check that the debit and credit matches, 91.3 plus 55.7 is going to be 147, and 84 plus 63 is going to be 147. So the debit and credit is now matched. So this is how we are going to summarize the entire table into what is going to P&L, what is going to OCI, and what is the non-current liability in the balance sheet, and how all this complete accounting can be recorded in just a single entry, which was P&L debit, OCI debit, bank credit, and non-current liability credit. Now moving forward, if there is any question, you can ask over here. Please explain the bank figure in the double entry. The bank basically is the amount of the contribution. The company has contributed into the fund. So this amount, this contribution will reduce the company's bank balance. Subhan is asking to explain the double entry again. Subhan, the entry is pretty simple. The final value of P&L is going to be expensed out, debited. The remeasurement loss will go to OCI. The bank is the amount of contribution, and the non-current liability brought down and carried down. Carried down is 126 and brought down was 42. So the increase in the non-current liability is 84. We have credited the liability by this $84 million. So this is how we have prepared the double entry. Normally, if the question is being asked in the consolidation question, in that case, this entry will be very important, because at the end of the adjustment, you need a double entry to be posted in the financial statements. Cindy is asking to explain the curtailment and settlement. Cindy, the amount of curtailment and settlement was given in the question, being 5 million and 6 million. So we have just posted this. The details were being discussed prior to this question. So if you have joined us late, you can refer to this to that video, which will be available most probably by tomorrow. Okay, now let's move forward, and we are discussing the concept of asset ceiling. What is asset ceiling is that, let's suppose that carried forward of net liability, the final column, can be a negative value and can be a positive value. Normally, this value is a positive value, which means that the liability, that the amount is a net liability. But in case, if that amount becomes negative, this would mean that the amount is a net asset. Like, for example, if I move back, and for example, for a while, I say that I think the rubber is not working properly. Let me write over here. Like, for example, I say that the DBO carried down is 10 million and the plan asset carried down is 8 million. In this case, the net liability will be 2 million. And as this value is a positive, it will become a net liability. But if the DBO is 10 million and the plan asset is 12 million, in this case, the amount will become a negative value, and that negative value will be called a net asset. If the amount is positive, the carried down calculated is going to be the carried forward figure, and this value is going to be taken into the balance sheet. But if the answer is a negative value, the value taken to the balance sheet will be the lower of the carried down that we have calculated, which in this case is 2 million, and the present value of the economic benefit, which will be given to you in the question. So let's suppose the present value given to you is 1.5 million and the carried down that you have calculated in the table is 2 million. So whichever value is lower is going to be taken into the balance sheet. So in this case, the value to be shown in the balance sheet is going to be the $1.5 million. Muhammad Hassan is asking, when will you guide us about how to answer the question? Muhammad Hassan, we will be moving towards the past papers immediately after this slide. So we are going to discuss this over there. Okay, termination benefits. Termination benefit is very minor area, so you can cover this at home as well. So there are simply two points: that in case of termination benefit, the expense is recorded earlier of the date of termination and the date when the criteria as per IAS 37 are met. So for example, these are two different years. On 30th June of the previous year, the company announces that it is going to restructure on the 30th June of the next year. So the company has prepared a detailed formal plan and has announced. So in this case, the criteria will be met on the 30th June of the first year. So the expense will be recorded on this date. But let's suppose the company has prepared a plan but has not announced, and on 30th June, the company directly restructures the company and removes some of the employees. So in this case, the expense will be recorded on 30th June of the second year. So the expense is simply recorded at the earlier of. If the employee has been terminated first without any announcement, expense will be recorded at the date of termination. And if it was previously announced to the employee, the expense will be recorded when the criteria were being met. If few students want to see the slide of asset ceiling, this is the slide of asset ceiling. Mehnaz is asking, where will we enter the negative net asset amount? Mehnaz, the negative value will be treated as an asset. That means it will be shown as a non-current asset. It will be shown with non-current assets below before writing down the current assets. Okay, so now moving towards the past papers, because past papers is one of the most important areas of any accounting standard. So first we try to obtain the knowledge, and then we try to apply the knowledge on the exam scenarios. So let's move forward. This is a question of June 2017, which is the recent attempt. This was a question number one by the name of Diamond, and this relates to IAS 19. Now the question says that Diamond operates a defined benefit pension scheme. The question has clearly mentioned that this is a defined benefit scheme. On 31st March 2017, the company announced that it was to close down a business division and agreed to pay each of its 150 staff a cash payment of 50,000. So when the company is closing down the business, it seems that the question is moving towards curtailment. Because when we are going to close the business, we are obviously going to terminate the employees. And when the employees are terminated, obviously their pension plan is also terminated. So that will fall under the case of curtailment. So the company announced that it was to close down a business division and agreed to pay each of its 150 staff a cash of 50,000. So this means that this is a case of curtailment with settlement, where we are also paying an amount to the employees. So one important thing is that the company has agreed to pay. The company has not yet paid the amount, which means that this shall be treated as a liability. What amount of liability? 150 people into 50,000. So this will be 150 into 50,000, which will be giving us 7,500,000. I'm right now writing the values in thousands. Further, the question says to compensate them for loss of the pension arising from the wage inflation. The objective is to compensate the loss of the pension. It is estimated that closure will reduce the present value of the pension obligation by 5.8 million. So DBO, which is a non-current liability, will be reduced by 5.8 million, and if we are writing the values in thousands, it will be 5,800. Diamond is unsure of how to deal with the settlement and curtailment and has not yet recorded anything within its financial statements. So the liability, the pension liability, was 5.8, and we have agreed to pay 7.5. So which means that this is a case of a loss. So the differential value shall be recorded in P&L, 7,500 minus 5,800 is going to give us a difference of 1,700. So this was a simple entry which was to be recorded in the previous attempts question. So the students would be aware of the treatment of curtailment settlement, they would have scored good. And for those students who were unable to prepare the correct entry, I think they can now easily attempt this. Nabil is asking from where you got the June attempt. It is not ACCA website. Can you share the link? Nabil, I have downloaded the question paper from the ACCA website. Actually, the paper published, in that paper, the question 1 and question 4. Actually, now ACCA publishes a hybrid paper, where two questions of paper P2 relates to June and two paper to March. Similarly, for December, two questions from September and two questions from December. So the paper published by ACCA has question 1 of June 17, question 4 of June 17, question 2 and 3 of March 17. So from there I have got the question, so you can refer to it, and if you still face problem, you can post it on the WhatsApp group. I will give you the link over there. Okay, now let's move forward. This is a December 2006 question. Question number 1, and the name is not Diamond, the name is Zippy. This was basically an income statement question. So these are the two recent attempts where IAS 19 has been asked. So in this question, the question says that the following information relates to Zippy's defined benefit pension scheme. Again, the question has clearly mentioned that the plan is a defined benefit plan. The net pension deficit at 30th June 2015, which means that this is a net liability. The deficit word denotes that the liability is higher than the plan asset. So the net liability brought down is 14 million. Service cost for the year, that means current service cost for the year, was 10 million. Contribution into the scheme was 8 million. Opening discount rate was 10 and the closing discount rate was 12. Which rate are we going to use, opening or the closing? Opening rate, exactly, opening rate. We have already discussed this, that if both the rates have been given to you, you are going to use the opening rate, which is 10%. And the remeasurement gain was 4 million. Now the question says that no entries have been entered in the financial statements except for the contribution into the scheme, which have been correctly added to the pension scheme's assets. So the question has correctly recorded the accounting for the contribution. So what is left? The service cost is left, the remeasurement gain is left, and the interest is left. So if we calculate the interest, it will be 14 million brought down into 10%, which is 1.4 million. Similarly, the service cost will be of 10 million. Both of these are going to be recorded in P&L, which is 11.4. And the remeasurement gain is going to be taken to OCI, and as it is a gain, this will give a credit balance. So we can say P&L debit by 11.4, OCI credit by 4, and the remaining amount will relate to non-current liabilities. So the non-current liability will be increased by 7. So this was a simple entry that was to be recorded in December 2016 question. So normally IAS 19 question is not a very difficult one, it's not a very challenging one. If you know the table, if you know the values from where to pick, from where to report in the financial statements, you can easily handle the question. Okay, now let's move further. This is again a past paper question by the name of Cochin. Cochin has decided to restructure one of its business segments. The plan was agreed by the board of directors on 1st January 2015 and affects employees in two locations. In the first location, half of the factory units have been closed. Half of the factory units have been closed by 31st March 2015. And the affected employees' pension benefits have been frozen, which means that we are not going to pay any amount against the pension benefit to the employees. The word frozen means that we have curtailed the liability and we have not paid any amount against it. Any new employee would not be eligible to join the defined benefit plan. The previous employees, the benefit have been frozen and no new employee is going to be a part of the plan. After the restructuring, the present value of the defined benefit obligation in this location is 8 million. 8 million is the present value after restructuring. After restructuring, present value is 8 million. The following table relates to location 1 and the values before restructuring are such that the present value is 10, plan asset is 7 and net liability is 3. So the only thing that you have to do is that the $10 million liability before restructuring has now changed to $8 million after restructuring. So what you were expected to do is that you just have to reduce the liability of by $2 million and record a gain of 2 million in P&L. So this was the simple entry that was to be recorded in this question. Mohammed Hassan is asking, what about vested and non-vested? Mohammed Hassan, there is no more the concept of vested and non-vested because the treatment is the same. If the past service cost is vested and if it is non-vested, the treatment is the same. So there is no further need of classifying the past service cost as vested and non-vested. Normally the classification applies where the accounting treatment is different, but where the accounting treatment is same, we don't need to classify those items. So this was the case of Cochin, and again the Cochin question also had a second location. So this now relates to the same question but location number 2 now. So the question says that all activities have been discontinued. All activities have been discontinued in the second location as well. It has been agreed that employees will receive a payment of 4 million. Employees will receive, which means that this amount has not yet been paid. It will be paid in exchange for the pension liability of 2.4 million. So this means that this is a case of curtailment and settlement. The amount of curtailment is 2.4 and the amount of settlement is 4 million. In the unfunded pension scheme, which means that there is no fund prepared for this, Kuchin estimates that the cost of the above restructuring. Okay, now let's solve till over here, then we will be reading further. So in this case, what we are going to do is that we will be reducing the non-current liability by 2.4 million. This is the amount by which we have reduced the liability, and we are going to pay them $4 million instead. So the $4 million is a current liability because we will be paying this amount shortly. So this will result in a loss of $1.6 million. So this is a pretty simple question and a similar question to the one that was being asked in June 2017 attempt. So the adjustment of IAS 19 in June 2017 was a repeated adjustment. So I think that that adjustment was not to be treated incorrectly in the paper. That was those were easy marks. So now the question further says that Kuchin estimates that the cost of the above restructuring excluding pension costs. Now the question is talking about restructuring the area of IAS 37. So Kuchin estimates that the above cost of restructuring excluding pension cost will be 6 million. This 6 million is other than 4 and other than the previous values of the first location. Kuchin has not accounted for the effect of the restructuring in its financial statements because it is planning a right issue and does not wish to depress the share price. Therefore, there has been no formal announcement of the restructuring. There is no formal announcement of the restructuring. Now the question is whether should we record the $6 million as an expense and as a liability under IAS 37 or not. Should we record 6 million as a liability or not? I want your feedback on this. Hassan Khan is saying yes, Dennis saying no. More answers, I will be wanting more answers. Okay, no, record, should record, no liability, liability, no, yes, no, yes, no, sir. Okay, a lot of answers. Okay, now again, as per IAS 37, there are two criterias. Which two? There should be a detailed formal plan and it should be announced. But announced to whom? Announced in the market to the shareholder or the employees? By announcement, we mean announced to the affected parties, which are normally employees. Now listen to my word clearly. The question is saying that in the second location, all activities have been discontinued and we haven't informed the employees. All activities have been discontinued and we haven't informed the employees. Is it possible? If all of the activities have been discontinued, employees would obviously know that the activity has been discontinued. Plus, it has been agreed that the employees will receive a payment of 4 million. With whom have we agreed? With the employees. And we haven't informed the employees. Is it possible? No. This means that by formal announcement, the question is referring to someone other than the employee. Maybe the plan is not announced to the shareholder. Maybe the plan is not announced to the market. But obviously, when I've agreed with the employee that we are discontinuing the operation, I will pay you 4 million instead of 2.4. This means that the plan has been announced. Similarly, if I move back onto location one, Question said that in first location, half of the factory units have been closed. The factory units have been closed and we haven't informed the employee. The factory units has been closed and we haven't informed the employee. Is it possible? Obviously not. So again, by no formal announcement, the question is referring to someone else, someone other than the employee. Therefore, we will treat this as that at the conditions of IAS 37 are being met, and we are going to record the liability and we are going to record the expense by $6 million. So this is how the remaining question of IAS 37 was to be treated. Ailera is asking that, so if we have not announced, we would not expenses. Yes, Ailera, if we hadn't announced to the employee, which means that we were still continuing the operations, we were still continuing the activities, we were still continuing the factories, but we had planned to discontinue and we haven't informed the employees. Once we have discontinued the activities, obviously the employees would know. Batul is asking to repeat the first area. Batul, there was some problem in your laptop. So it would be better if you refer to this, the first question in the recorded slides. What I can do is for you is that I can show you the screen so that you can take the snapshot, the screenshot for your reference. But for detail, you will have to refer to the recorded lectures, which will be available by tomorrow. There's a question that how should we record the $6 million? Okay. The $6 million is basically a current liability. So the entry will be expense debit by $6 million and current liability credit by $6 million. Because most probably we will be paying this amount shortly, within few days, within few months, as the factories have been closed, the activities have been discontinued. So we will be paying the employees very soon. Mohammed Hassan is asking if they just had planned to discontinue and hadn't announced. So what would be the case? Mohammed Hassan, in that case, we will not record the liability of six and the remaining accounting will remain the same. Menaz is asking that, sir, how will we prepare the answer for the second part of the question? Menaz, for the second part, as this question is basically a consolidation question, so what you have to do is just you have to prepare the double entries. That's it. If it would have been a section B question, in that case, you would have written some theory as well. Guang is asking that P&L of 6 million refers to the current service cost, right? No, Guang, 6 million is basically the curtailment expense. Sorry, the restructuring expense of IAS 37. This 6 million relates to IAS 37. This is not IAS 19. This was a combined question of 19 and 37 being asked by the examiner. Okay, now let's move forward. I would recommend that you people should do the trailer question on your own so that we can save time for IFRS 15 as well and move towards some further questions. Now, this is a Section B question. Section B question has not been asked since a long time. In the recent 5 years, the question of IAS 19 has not been asked in Section B. Now, this means that very soon the question may be asked. So therefore, let's cover one question of Section B as well. So this is a June 2010 question, which is question number 2, part B. The question says that in its 2010 financial statements, Kate disclosed the existence of a voluntary fund established in order to provide a post-retirement benefit plan to employees. This is a company, Kate, who has developed a voluntary fund in order to provide benefit to the employees. Now the question further says that Kate considers its contribution to the plan to be voluntary. Kate considers its contribution to be voluntary and has not recorded any related liability in its consolidated financial statements. Kate thinks that there is no liability on Kate because the contribution is voluntary. So if Kate wants to contribute, it will contribute, and if it does not want to contribute, it will not contribute. So for what the liability shall be recorded? This is the thinking process of the company Kate. Now the question says that Kate has a history of paying benefits to its former employees, even increasing them to keep pace with inflation since the commencement of the plan. So this history, this informal behavior, this informal attitude of paying benefit to the employees and even increasing them with the inflation would create a constructive obligation on the company. And the benefits, if I see it, the question does not mention that the benefit will be based on the assets of the fund, will be based solely on the contribution. No, the benefit is also increasing to keep pace in the inflation. So this means that the benefit is not solely depending on the assets of the fund. Now the question further says that the main characteristics of the plan are as follows. The plan is totally funded by Kate. The contribution for the plan are made periodically. These two points are irrelevant because from these points we cannot identify whether the plan is a contribution plan or a plan is a benefit plan. So these point, both of these points are irrelevant. Now the question further says that the post-retirement benefit is calculated. Post-retirement benefit is calculated on a percentage of the final salary of the plan participants dependent on the years of service. This means that benefit is a predefined formula and is not solely based on the assets of the fund. So from this point, it seems that this is a defined benefit plan, which the question has also mentioned previously as well. But the previous statement was a generic statement. Right now, the characteristics of the plan are denoting the plan to be a benefit plan. Further, the question says that the annual contribution to the plan are determined as a function of the fair value of the assets less liabilities arising from the past service. How is the contribution calculated? We have no concern with this. Now the question further says that Kate argues that it should not have to recognize the plan. Kate thinks that the plan should not be recorded because according to the underlying contract, it can terminate its contribution to the plan if and when it wishes. Now there is something fishy with Kate in this case. There is a contract and Kate is saying that the contribution is voluntary. So this means that Kate does not have the constructive obligation only. Rather, the contract may also create a legal obligation on Kate, for which the question mentions that the termination clause of the contract establishes that Kate must immediately purchase lifetime annuities from the insurance company for all retired employees. So if Kate terminates its contribution, it has to purchase lifetime annuities. And if Kate does not purchase the lifetime annuities, it has to contribute. In either cases, Kate has to pay an amount either to the fund or to the insurance company, which means that this amount is a liability on Kate. And Kate will have to record the liability and treat the plan as a defined benefit plan because Kate has both legal and constructive obligation to provide benefit to the employees. Okay, now this was the overview of the question. Now, what are the exact points that you are going to write in the exam? And how are you going to write in the exam? For this, let's move on to the next slide. Answer to Kate. Now, this is the complete answer. This is how you are going to write. First, in the first point, I have defined what is a defined contribution plan. So plan where company pays a fixed contribution into the separate fund and has no further legal or constructive obligation is treated as a defined contribution plan. And then I've mentioned about a defined benefit plan, that all post-employment benefit plans that do not qualify as a defined contribution plan are therefore a defined benefit plan. So you should start your answer with some general points that are going to give the direction to your answer. So we have started from the two type of the plan, contribution plan and the benefit plan. And then we are going to identify the plan from this. Now the third point, the plan is not a defined contribution plan. There were two plans, contribution benefit. Now we are saying this is not a contribution plan. Why? Because CATE has a legal and, this is not or, CATE has a legal and constructive obligation to pay further contributions. After contributing into the fund, CATE's liability has not been finished. CATE is still liable. If CATE terminates the further contribution, it has to purchase the lifetime annuities. Plus, the informal practice of paying the benefit to its former employees creates a constructive obligation on the CATE. Now I am defining from where do I think that there is a constructive obligation. So first we started with two type of plans. Then we said this is not a contribution plan. Then we are proving that why it is a defined benefit plan, because CATE has both legal and constructive obligation. Then in the next point we mentioned how CATE has a constructive obligation, and we will also mention how CATE has a legal obligation. In the last point I've written that if CATE opts to terminate, CATE is responsible for discharging the liability created by the plan. CATE has to pay the liability somehow, either through contribution or through purchasing the lifetime annuities. This creates a legal obligation on CATE. So now our answer was based on the legal and constructive obligation. Now we are proving how are these legal and constructive obligation on how do these obligations exist in case of CATE. And the last point is that the benefit is not linked solely to the amount of the contribution. So again, this is not a contribution plan, and when it is not a contribution plan, it is a benefit plan. So this is how you're going to plan your answer, that what is the basis of identifying and how I'm going to prove according to the question. Thank you, Nabil, for the compliment. Okay, so now this question has been done, and I think this slide has been copied again. Now let's move on to IFRS 15. We have completed IS 19, and we are again short of time. 30 minutes left. So in 30 minutes we have to cover IFRS 15, and we have to solve some example questions as well. There are two questions of section B again. So in those two questions again, we are going to discuss how to read the question, how to take out the point from the question, how to plan your answer, and how to deliver your answer. So this is the complete procedure of scoring marks from the examiner. So now we will be going through IFRS 15 very quickly and moving on to the past papers so that we focus more for the in the exam scenario. So IFRS 15 has a five-step model where we record the revenue based on the five steps. Step one is identifying the control. Actually, this is not identifying the control. This is identifying the contract. There are some typing errors, so I will be correcting them during the lecture. So it will be easier for you if you take the snapshots of these so that whenever you are revising the area, you are able to correct these things as well. So now, identifying the contract. Step one is to check whether the contract is complete or not. So when does we count a contract to be complete? We count the contract as complete when it is approved by both parties. So for example, I have a contract, I have signed the contract, but you haven't signed the contract. This means that IFRS 15 is not going to apply until you have signed the contract, because both parties have not yet approved. Rights and responsibilities are clearly defined. According to the contract, what are my rights? What I'm going to receive, and what is my responsibility? What I'm going to deliver to you should also be clearly defined. Payment terms are identified. What is the payment terms? What amount am I going to receive? Whether it will be cash, non-cash, at what time am I going to receive the cash? Maybe the cash is going to be paid after 2 years, 3 years, 4 years. So in that case, we will be calculating the present value as well. So the payment terms should be clearly identified, rights and responsibilities should be clearly defined, and it should be agreed by both the parties, so that we should be aware of for what purposes have we signed the contract. Now, step two, identifying the performance objectives. By performance objectives, what we mean? We mean the promise made according to the contract. So for example, if me and you have a contract that I will provide you, I will supply you a calculator and I will supply you an AC remote. So I have a contract where I am going to provide you these two assets. So these two are two different performance objectives. One promise to provide you the calculator and one promise to provide you the remote. So identify the promises made to provide goods or services. Secondly, goods are distinct if they can be sold separately. So now let's suppose this is a calculator and this is a remote. Are these two distinct? Yes, because these two can be sold separately. But for example, if I say that the AC remote has also two parts, the remote and the cover. So are these two separate performance objectives, or is this a single performance objective? So accounting standard says that if these two can be sold separately, these are two assets. But if these two cannot be sold separately, this is a single asset, irrespective of that the company is providing it, the remote at a separate time and the cover at a separate time. The timing of the delivery of both does not matter. What matters is that can these be sold separately or not? If not, they are a single asset. If they can be sold separately, they are distinct. So first, identify the contract, whether it is complete or not. Second, identify the promises that you have made. Third, identifying the transaction price. Consideration that the entity expects to receive is called the transaction price. Consideration that the company expects to receive is the transaction price. Now the word expects needs some clarity. For that, let's move on to bullet number two. To make this more clear, let's move on to bullet number three to make it more clear. Variable consideration is only included if highly probable. Now, what is a variable consideration? Let's say that I have made a contract that I will be providing you a calculator within 10 days. I will be providing the calculator within 10 days and I will be charging, let's suppose, $20 for this calculator. In how many days I'm going to deliver you? 10 days. Now our contract also says that if I take more than 10 days, you will charge a penalty of 10%. And if I deliver you in less than 5 days, you will give me a premium of 10%. If I delay for more than 10 days, a penalty of 10% will apply. And if I deliver you within 5 days, a premium of 10% will apply. Now, which means that there is a variable consideration of 20%, which we may receive or we may not receive. So when we are going to record the revenue, this should be based on the expectation. Like, let's suppose my expectation, which is highly probable, is that I will be delivering you the calculator in 7 days, which means that the transaction price to be considered is $20 million. But if it is highly probable that I will be able to deliver you the product in 12 days, in that case the transaction price is $18, which is 10% after deducting the penalty of 10%. And if it is highly probable that I will deliver you the calculator in 3 days, in that case the transaction price is $22 million. So the transaction price may be 18, may be 20, or may be 22, and this depends on the expectation, and that expectation should be highly probable where there is variable consideration. Now the last point, any amount received from the customer. Again, there is some error. Any amount paid to the customer. Normally, when I sell goods, for example, I'm selling you this calculator, I am the party who's going to receive cash. But let's assume that with this calculator, I am giving you a $5 cash as well, and I'm receiving $20 from you. Giving you calculator and $5 and receiving $20. So what is the transaction price? 20 minus 5, which I'm giving you, which means that the calculator is of $15. Similarly, if I'm giving you a calculator and I'm giving you a toffee as well, and I'm receiving $20 from you, I'm giving you these two areas. So the price of the calculator is $20 minus the price of the toffee. So that will be the transaction price of this calculator. So any amount that we are paying to the customer will reduce our transaction price. Nabil is asking, so what about delivery of calculator with free service in the future? So we are still going to account for that. Yes, Nabil. One thing we have to remember that there is nothing which is free. There is nothing which is free. For example, with this calculator, I'm giving you a pen free. This means that the pen is not free. The price that I'm quoting includes the price of both. So for example, I'm selling you a calculator with free service. So the service is not free. The service charges are included in the price of the calculator. So in that case, we will say that there are two performance objectives: providing the good, which is calculator, and providing the services. And the transaction price relates to both of them. Now, step number four. Step four is to allocate the transaction price to the performance objectives. So what price is being charged for which promise? So the allocation should be based on relative standalone selling prices of the goods. The allocation should be based on the relative standalone prices. Now let's suppose there are two different products which I'm selling. Product A and product B. I'm selling you two different products, product A, product B. Now the price of product A is, let's say, $6. And the price of product B is, let's say, $4, which makes that the total price is $10. So for example, if I am charging you $10 for the both, what is the allocation? 4 and 6. If I am charging you 10, the allocation is 4 and 6, which is based on the relative standalone prices. But if, let's say, I am giving you a discount, I say product A is of 6, product B is of 4, the total is 10, but I am giving you this for 8, which means that there is a discount of $2. Now, to which product should we allocate the discount? Should the discount be allocated to product A or product B? For this, let's refer to point number 2, where the transaction price includes a variable amount and discount. They can be allocated to one or more separate performance objectives. The standard has given you to decide, given you the leverage to decide that for which product have you given the discount. Normally, the discounts are given where one product is a running product and the other product is not a running product. For example, normally people buy a calculator from me, but no one buys the pen. So what will I do? I will create a combination, a bucket, a package, and I will say that go for this package at a reduced price. So I know that for which product have I given the discount? For the pen. So the standard allows us that you can allocate the $2 discount to any specific product, which means that the breakup of $8 is that $6 for A and $2 for B. Standard allows you to do this. And let's say this is not the case. Rather, I have given the discount for product A. So in that case, the price of product A will be 4 and the price of product B will also be 4. So this will be the allocation of 8. And if I have given the discount for both, I have given a discount for both. I cannot allocate to any single product. In that case, what we do is that we allocate it proportionately. Like, according to the standalone price, which was 10, product A is 60% of the total, and product B is 40% of the total. Again, based on the standalone prices, we are talking based on the standalone prices, that product A is 60% and product B is 40%. So 80%, so 60% of 8 will belong to product A, and 40% of 8 will belong to product B. This will be the allocation of the total price of 8. So the standard has given the leverage to the company to decide for which product are we giving the discount. Mohammed Bilal is asking, even in warranties? Yes, Mohammed Bilal, even in warranties, if we are giving the warranty against some payment, that will fall under IFRS 15. But if the warranty is given free of cost, that warranty will fall under IS 37. That is something else. Mohammed Hassan is asking, if you don't mind and allow during this first week session, so can we ask questions next day of the topic you teach? Okay, Mohammed Bilal, this is something that very difficult for us, because if you are asking the questions relating to the previous day, so all the other students will be sort of waiting for your question every time. So therefore, what we will do is that we will be creating a WhatsApp group for you people. You people can join over there, and you people can ask your relevant questions over there. So what happens is that there are a lot of students. For example, 200 students are there in a group, and one asks a question. So there are 199 people who can answer your question. So this way, what happens is that students ask questions and student answers the question. So it will be easier for both of you, for the person who's asking the question, and for the person who is replying the question. In case you do not get a proper response over there, then you can ask me your question on the WhatsApp. You will be having my number on the group, so you can directly message me on the WhatsApp and ask your question over there, so that your question takes only my and your time, no one else. Why should other people wait for your question? So that's why it will be better if we keep this for a separate session rather than including this in the current session. Taha is asking how to get add on the WhatsApp group. Taha, I will be sharing the link of the WhatsApp group. That will be a public link. You will simply click on that, and you will be automatically added in the WhatsApp group. So I will be posting the group by day end, within 10 to 15 minutes, because we have only 16 minutes left. So I will be posting that link over there. Gwang is asking, may I know step three, you change the received from to what word? Gwang, I had changed the received from to paid. Any amount paid to the customer. This is any amount paid to the customer. Any amount paid to the customer. Okay, welcome. Okay, now let's move on to step number five. This is the last step, and then we will be moving on to the past papers. Step five is recognizing the revenue when performance objectives are met. So as soon as I will be completing my promises, delivering the goods, delivering the services, I will start to recognize the revenue. Now we say that the performance objective is met when the control of the goods or services is transferred. The performance objective is met when the control has been transferred. And how do we identify whether the control has been transferred? Factors that may indicate, these are some indications, the passing of the control include the present right to payment for the asset. If I have the right to receive my payment, that means the control has been transferred. For example, I am making a pen for you. Now you may use the pen or you may not use the pen. But I am making the pen for you, and once I have made the pen, my right to payment has been developed. Whether you come to take the pen or not, whether you use it or not, I have the right to payment. This means the control has been transferred to you, because my right has been developed. Secondly, the customer has the legal title to the asset. For example, I have made a pen for you. I haven't delivered it to you, but the legal title, I have transferred the legal title to you. I have the pen. I haven't delivered the pen to you, but I have transferred the legal title of the pen. This means the control has been transferred. And third, the entity has transferred physical possession of the asset. I have given the pen to you. Now the control has been transferred. So either the legal title transfers, the physical possession transfers, or my right to receive the payment develops, the control has been transferred and the revenue shall be recognized. The last point is that the revenue shall be recognized in line with the pattern of transfer. Revenue should be recognized in line with the pattern of transfer, that is percentage of completion. So for example, I am giving you services. For example, we have a webinar of 6 days, 17 hours, and I have given you 3 hours. So I would say that out of 17, 3 hours has been done. This means that the percentage of completion is 17.6%. So I can recognize 17.6% of the revenue. So this is where we say that the revenue shall be recognized in line with the pattern of transfer. The percentage of the goods or services transferred, the revenue can be recognized for that. Sayyed Imad is asking, sorry, I didn't get you properly for the WhatsApp group. Will you be adding us through our phone numbers? Sayyed Imad, we will be sharing a public link on this message box. We will be sharing a public link on this message box. And whenever you click that link through your mobile phone, you will be automatically added to the WhatsApp group. So this way it will be easier for you and for me as well. I would not be required to add every single student. That will be a public link. If there is a friend of yours who wants to join, you can simply forward the link. Whoever will click on the link will be added in the group. Irfan is asking that, like IS 11. Yes, Irfan, like IS 11, but IS 11 does not exist now in our course. So it is entirely the same, but with reference to IFRS 15. Okay, now let's move on to the questions, the past papers. This is an example question one, where the question says that during January 2016, Innovate entered into a contract with major supermarket chain. The supermarket agreed to purchase 300,000 copies of Innovate games over a 2-year period for a total price of $3 million. So we have agreed that I will be giving 300,000 copies to you. This is the responsibility on me. And what I will be getting is $3 million. So the rights and responsibilities are clearly defined. The rights and responsibilities have been clearly defined and the payment terms are clear. So this means that the step one has met. At the start of the contract, Innovate paid $0.2 million to the supermarket. Who is Innovate? Let's read again. Innovate entered into the contract with the supermarket chain. The supermarket agreed to purchase 300,000 copies of Innovate. Seller in this case is Innovate. And the buyer is, is there a name given? Supermarket. Now, if we see, the seller should receive the payment. But the question says that 0.2 million has been paid by Innovate. This means that the supplier is paying to the customer. The supplier is paying to the customer. So we had discussed it previously that any amount paid to the customer will be reduced from the transaction price. So this means that the transaction price is going to be $3 million, which Innovate will be receiving, minus $0.2 million, which will give us a transaction price of $2.8 million. So any amount which we are paying will reduce the transaction price. So now let's read further that Innovate paid 0.2 million to the supermarket to compensate it for the changes that needed to be made to the shop in order to display the games. So Innovate has paid this amount so that in the supermarket, the area is properly built for those games of Innovate. At the end of the contract, Innovate will be entitled to an extra 0.3 million if their delivery times and product reliability have met a range of criteria decided by the supermarket. So 0.3 million will be received on a condition. So we will say that this 0.3 million is a variable consideration. We may receive this and we may not receive this. So this variable consideration will only be included if it is highly probable. Now let's see by reading the question further that whether it is highly probable or not. The question mentions that Innovate has not previously entered into similar contract, and so the directors remain unsure as to whether the criteria is met. The directors are unsure, which means that the variable consideration shall not be incorporated. So the transaction price will remain at 2.8. If, for example, the question would have mentioned that 0.3 million is highly probable, in that case, the transaction price would have become 3.1. 2.8 plus 0.3. But right now, it is not highly probable. So the transaction price will remain at 2.8. By 30th June 2016, Innovate had delivered 50,000 copies. 50,000 copies out of 300,000, which means that the percentage of completion is 50 divided by 300, which is 16.67%. And this means that 16.67% of the revenue shall be recorded. Now the question further says, and it was deemed that the control over these had passed. So the control has been passed, the revenue can be measured reliably, the contract is complete, the payment terms are clearly defined, the variable consideration is not to be included, we have a complete grip on the question. And now let's see that how shall we answer this. We are going to start the answer by mentioning the transaction price. That what is a transaction price? We always try to start the answer with a general point. But that general point should be a focused area of the question. Like, for example, you are starting the allocation of the transaction price. That is irrelevant. So you have to start with a general point, but that applies to the question. So we have written that transaction price is the amount that the entity expects to receive. Any consideration paid to the customer is treated as a deduction in the transaction price. And then we have mentioned 3 million minus 0.2 million. That the transaction price is 2.8 million. So you can say that this can be a first paragraph of your answer, where with reference to IFRS 15, you are defining what is transaction price and how do we treat the payment from the payment to the customer. And then you are applying on the scenario and ending with a conclusion at the end of the paragraph that the transaction price in this case is 2.8. Now you can start a new paragraph from over here that variable consideration can only be included if it is highly probable. Now we are talking about 0.3 million. Therefore, 0.3 million shall not be included in revenue because Innovate does not have enough experience of such transactions. Innovate's director was still unsure that whether the conditions are met or not because this is the first time that they have entered into such a transaction. Therefore, we will say that the criteria are not met. Now, if the control is transferred over a period of time, because in this case, the control is transferring over 2 years. Revenue is also recorded over a period of time. So the revenue will also be recorded over 2 years. If you want to further continue, you can mention based on the percentage of completion or based on the percentage of the goods, delivered. Now, concluding the point, the revenue recorded should be 0.4 million, which is 2.8 into 16.67%. So this is the amount of the revenue that should be recorded by Innovate. PS is asking to refer to the previous slide. PS, this is the previous slide. You can take a snapshot. Nabil, this is a mock question basically that was being asked by ACCA mock exam in June 2017 attempt. So this is how you are expected to tackle the question in the real exam. Now let's move further. We are also short of time, so we will be quickly discussing the question, and the answer is obviously available with you. Just give me a minute. I am discussing with the admin to provide you the WhatsApp group link so that before ending the session you are able to join it. So I'm pausing the screen. Meanwhile, you go through the question, then we will be discussing this. Okay, everyone, so admin is going to share the WhatsApp group link to you people so that all of you people are connected with me as well and with each other as well. So now let's go through the question. We are very short of time, only 1 minute left. Mohammed Fahad wants to take a snapshot of the previous screen. Mohammed Fahad quickly. Wang is asking if 0.3 million becomes probable, I should add up 2.8 first, then only times with percentage of completion. Yes, Guang, you, if it would have been highly probable, the transaction price would have been 3.1. So all calculations in that case will be performed on 3.1. But for example, if the question says that it is 90% probable, then it will be 0.3 into 90% plus 2.8. Okay, now let's quickly discuss example question number 2 of IFRS 15. This is a music company. Music is a company that has a reporting date of 30th June 2016. As at 30th June 2016, music was partway through creating a television advertisement. Partway through creating a television advertisement for Motion. A major technology company, music is responsible for designing, filming, and editing the advertisement. So the role is clearly defined. which is due to be broadcast on television in September 2017. So music company is preparing an advertisement for motion company. It is a bespoke advertisement and music would be unable to sell it to another customer. It is a bespoke system. That means that only motion can use this ad and no one else can use this ad. Progress towards the completion of the product was estimated to be 70%. 70% of the advertisement has been prepared at the reporting date. Consideration payable by Motion takes two forms. Motion is going to pay us in two forms. State-of-the-art filming equipment. One, they are going to provide us the filming equipment with a fair value of $1.2 million and a useful life of 3 years. So they are going to provide us an equipment of $1.2 million. Which was delivered to Music already to use on 1st April 2016. So we have already received this. So what we can say is that we will record this as a property plant equipment, 1.2 million when we have received. And at that time, this is an unearned income for us. We have a sort of received the income, but we haven't earned it. This will also be a part of the transaction price. Cash of $2 million due on 30th November 2000. 16. So we can say that the transaction price is now 2.2 plus 1.2, 3.2 million. If Motion breaks the contract, Music can demand the payment for the work completed to date. Music can demand the payment for the work completed to date. This means that the control has been transferred because Music has the right to receive cash. As and when Music is developing the advertisement, the control is transferring. So we can say that 70% of the revenue can be immediately recorded because the control has been transferred based on what? That the right to receive cash has been developed. The directors of Music have posted no accounting entries in respect of this transaction and need advice as to the correct treatment. So now let's move on to the answer. So we will again start with a general point that revenue is recorded when control is transferred, which is transferred when the entity has the right to receive the payment. If you look, we have only mentioned the point that is applying in this scenario. We are not writing all three points, that legal title can be transferred, right to receive cash can be developed, or the physical possession can be given. No, we have already written that point, which is applying in the scenario. So this is called case-specific answer. You are not required to write the entire knowledge that you have in your mind. You have written five steps in this answer. No. You have to write the answer that is exactly applying on this question, on this scenario. Secondly, revenue is recorded over a period of time and the control is transferred over a period of time. As we are developing the advertisement slowly, gradually, so as we are completing, the revenue can be recorded. Music shall record. Now we are applying these points on the scenario. Music shall record the revenue over a period of time because as music company incurs cost, its right to receive the payment is created. Therefore, the control has been transferred. So now we have applied both of these general points to this case, that how in this case the control is being transferred. So the revenue recorded at the fair value of the consideration received, which is 3.2 million, 1.2 million of the state-of-art equipment and 2 million cash. Therefore, revenue should be 70% of 3.2 million, giving a value of 2.24 million. This is the amount of revenue to be recorded. And finally, equipment received shall be treated as an asset at 1.2 and depreciated over 3 years. So annual depreciation will become 0.4 million. And these are the entries that are to be recorded in the financial statements. The property, plant, equipment debited by 1.2. The revenue of 2.24, which we have calculated in the previous slide, 70% of 3.2. And the remaining amount being treated as a receivable because we haven't received this amount yet. Then we are going to depreciate the state-of-the-art equipment over 3 years and charging 3 months depreciation. Why 3 months depreciation? Because if I go back to the question, the product was being delivered on April 2016 and the company's year end was June 2016. So April, May and June. So we are going to charge depreciation for 3 months, which will be 1.2 divided by 3 into 3 by 12. So depreciation of 0.1, expense debit and asset credit. So this is how the second question was to be solved. We are 6 minutes beyond our target, but thank God that we have completed our target. If you have any questions or comments, you can post it. And do give the comments about the session so that we can incorporate your comments during the next 5 days. You can provide your positive feedback. You can provide your negative feedback. Both of the feedbacks will be useful for us. So thank you so much, and looking forward to meet you tomorrow. Bye-bye.